So I'm talking to you about the sifting process, and first thing I want to do is lay some biblical foundation here today. I'm going to read a couple of verses to you that speak about the spiritual process that we go through that's underneath the oversight of God. Have you given your life to Jesus? Is anybody going with Jesus all the way? Then let me tell you something. Your life is underneath the oversight of God Almighty, all right? And it is His heart that you would come to maturity. So I'm going to jump here with two or three verses. The book of James, chapter 1, verses 2 and 3, say this. It says, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds." Now, how many of you like to go through trials? Nobody, right? But the scripture says for us to consider it joy. It goes on to say, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance, and perseverance must finish its work so that you can be mature and complete, not lacking anything. You see, maturity is the end result of what God is looking for in our lives. God wants you to become a mature believer. What I'm talking about is not getting older, right? I'm not talking about that. We're all going to get older, but it's not about age. It's about personal spiritual growth, all right? Now let's go over to 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 6 and 7. Peter writes this. He says, "In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while." Everybody say a little while. I'm going to tell you something. Your tests and trials aren't going to last forever. This is just a season that God has you in, all right? "For a little while, you've had to suffer grief and all kinds of trials. These have come so that your faith of greater worth than gold, which perishes, even though refined by fire, may be proved genuine and may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed." You see, God's values are not necessarily the values of our American culture. God values maturity. He values completeness, right? God values the fact that our faith can be proved to be genuine. Amen. In fact, He says that's even more important than gold and silver. So now we're going to turn over to Luke chapter 22 and verse 31. And this is what we're going to be really focusing in on today. It says this, "Simon, Simon," Jesus is talking. He's about ready to go to the cross. And He says, "Simon, Simon." I want you to know He didn't say, "Simon, Simon." No. He said, "Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift you as wheat. But I've prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned back, strengthen your brothers." But He replied, "Lord, I'm ready to go with you to the prison and to death." And Jesus answered, "I tell you, Peter, before the rooster crows today, you will deny three times that you know me." Would you just join me in a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, I pray that you would take this beautiful message today of the processes that we go through. And I pray, God, for those who are going through the tests and the trial, God, I pray that you would allow them to sense your presence today and that you are in control of their life. In Jesus' name, amen. I think that believers go through various stages. We could even say seasons in their spiritual lives. These are spiritual growth stages, all right? And the first stage is preparation. When a believer is in the Word of God, do you realize you're preparing yourself? When you spend time in fasting and prayer, you are preparing your heart. And how many of you know that God loves that, right? When you spend time in worship and spending time in the presence of God, you are preparing yourselves. And when God sees you preparing your heart, what does He do? The next stage is that He blesses you, right? The blessings of God start flowing in your life. And that's the best stage, right? The blessing stage. And it's wonderful, right? God uses you. God does things. He starts showing up. It's just like His hand is on you and everything around you. It's wonderful. But you see, God's goal in life is not simply that we would be blessed. His ultimate goal is that we would become mature in Christ. And so what happens is that even though we're reading the Word, word, even though we're loving Jesus, there are some things in our life that he wants to get rid of in our life, right? And I've said this many times, and it's a beautiful truth. How many of you realize that God accepts you just as you are? Aren't you glad for that? Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me. But let me tell you something about Jesus. He loves you too much to let you stay in the same condition that you came to him, right? He will bring you into a process to change your heart and change your life. And this is the third stage. I call it the sifting stage. And this is the stage that nobody really ever talks about. People get confused about it. They don't understand what's going on in their life because a few days ago they were reading the word and then they were blessed. And now it just seems like there's troubles and trials and tribulations and heartaches and difficulties. And they're wondering what's going on. Well, let me tell you about sifting. We don't know much about sifting today, because we know all about iPhones and computers and technology, but we're not into, you know, grains and wheat, all right? But around every grain of wheat, there's a little piece of paper that's called chaff, and that has to be removed to get to what is useful. And sifting gets rid of what is not useful in our lives. And I believe that God allows us to go through a time of sifting so because our lives need to change. And it might be something small. It might be an attitude. It might be a sense of self-dependence. It might be some negativity or fear or doubt. Whatever it is, you see, God puts you in an amazing place where you have to trust God. Is there anybody that's ever been in that place where you have to trust God? I'll be honest with you, I hate that. Come on. I'm just being honest. I mean, it's hard to be in a place where you've just got to trust God, right? When this is happening, you know what it feels like? It feels like you're under satanic attack. It feels like it's a place where you need a lot of prayer. It feels like you're either going to stand or you're going to fall. But you've got to remember one thing. It's just a season, okay? And then the beautiful thing about it is, this season isn't going to last for long, but as you pass through it, there's another season that comes up. That's the maturation stage, all right? And all of a sudden, you look back at your life and you realize, man, I have really grown in the Lord. I'm stronger than I've ever been. You become mature, complete, right? Now, let me tell you, a lot of people preach about the preparation or about the harvest or the blessing and even about maturity, but not many people preach about getting sifted. So I'm going to talk about that today. How do you know serving God's a great thing, right? Because when you become a Christian, it's wondrous. Your sins are washed away. Jesus becomes your Savior. The principles of the Word of God are all right there for you. But you know, there's a common misconception that I think sometimes us preachers, pastors, evangelists, whoever, have sometimes communicated in an attempt to persuade people to follow the Lord. We've miscommunicated the following. Just because you're a Christian, that does not exempt you from flat tires. Right? Relational work, relational problems at work, you're not exempt from increased prices at the store, right? As amazing as it sounds, sometimes Christian people who really love God get the flu, okay? Sometimes they have car accidents. Their kids sometimes get rebellious. They face surgery. Sometimes they get laid off. In times of war, sometimes good Christian people actually become refugees and have to leave everything behind. Let me tell you something that's truly amazing. I have actually had to preach funerals for good Christian people. They're good Christian people. And guess what? They died, okay? All right, that was a little humor. Y'all aren't getting it this morning, all right? Just because you're a Christian, it doesn't exempt you from the trials of life. But now here's the key. Are you ready? The key is that there's a difference in the life of the Christian and the life of the person who's not a believer, okay? The Christian is put into a process, and everything that you go through in life, the good, the bad, the ugly, God never wastes a hurt. God's going to take it, and he's going to use it to refine you, to change you, to mold you, to chisel you, to transform you, to correct you, to chasten you, to challenge you, to grow you. Oh, come on. I think it's a wonderful thing, right? But if you don't know and understand that God is love, that he has your best interests at heart, at first it's almost like a horrifying thought. God is using everything around me to form me. He's using everything around me to transform me. And I can assure you that the moment you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you're going to start going through this process, and you're going to go around it and around it and around it and around it again. How many of you see I've took a few spins on that wheel myself? Hello? I've been prepared. I've been blessed. I've been sifted, and I've been matured. Amen? It's going to continue till Jesus comes, all right? And I want to give you four things that are real during the sifting process. Tell your neighbor, God is real. God is real all the time, right? These are things that are real during the sifting process. And we're going to see this in the life of Peter in Luke chapter 22. Let me give you the setting. Jesus is about ready to go to the cross. All right, and his goal in the development of his disciples was that they would become strong, mature believers in him, right? If the disciples had never been sifted, they would have never been able to withstand all the persecution, the opposition, the trials, even martyrdom. But they're facing this moment in their life, and they don't know what's going to happen. All they know is Jesus is getting ready to go to the cross for the sins of mankind, and Peter in particular had struggled with this issue. Back over in Matthew chapter 16, I'm going to read a verse for you. It's talking, this is a little bit before Luke 22 in the timeline. It says, from that time on, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things at the hands of the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, that he must be killed and on the third day raised to life. So Jesus is telling his disciples this, and Peter's just like, I need to straighten you out, Jesus. Can you come over here, Jesus? He pulled Jesus to the side. And he said, far be it from you, Lord. You're not going to die. That's not going to happen to you. And if you remember, if you read the story, Jesus literally has to rebuke Peter in a very strong way. He says, get behind me, Satan. So for Peter, this was really a huge, huge test. And so now we come to the point where, Jesus is almost headed to the cross, all right? And that's where Luke 22, where we read. And I want to give you four things that are real today when you're being sifted, all right? First of all, number one, Jesus understands our weakness. He understands our weakness. That is why he understood that for Peter, it was hard. He had already dealt with Peter about this. And he begins by talking to Peter, warning him, and he says, Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift you as wheat. And I believe we can see the compassion of Jesus, right? The love of Jesus for Peter. That warning didn't come sharply. It wasn't strong like a rebuke, but it began ever so gently in his own way, Jesus reminding Peter of his own weakness by saying his name. And you may wonder, well, why did he call him Simon instead of Peter? Well, if you remember back when Andrew brought his brother Simon to Jesus, Jesus told Simon, your name is Simon, which means a reed, but I'm going to call you Peter, which means a rock. And so what Jesus was saying to Peter was, look, you used to be like this, like a reed that was swayed by the wind, but I'm going to change you. I'm going to transform you over here into a rock, okay? And so Peter understood the moment Jesus started saying, Simon, Reed, okay? He understood what Jesus was saying. He was saying, Peter, I know who you are. I know the tendency that you have, and I understand your weakness. And aren't you glad today that Jesus understands our weakness? Amen? Jesus understands the things that we go through. And sometimes he'll call out to us, and he'll say, Bob. You know, he'll talk to us, right? And he'll warn us of things, and he'll tell us. And I think that Peter was actually, in that very moment, he was actually trying to be strong, wasn't he? He was saying, I'll go with you all the way, even to death if necessary. But the Lord knew that he was going to be sifted, all right? And the second thing that is very real in a season of sifting, not only does Jesus understand our weakness, but the second thing is that Satan